indeed. So, how's your morning been so far? Who has had their Easter eggs and finished them already?
Oh dear, no.
Who's had their Easter eggs? You've had your Easter eggs? Yes, everyone else? You haven't had your Easter eggs? No, I've not had the Easter eggs yet either. No, nothing. Have you had your Easter eggs yet? No. Oh dear. But some of us had. You've had a chocolate Easter egg.
With Smarties inside. That sounds like a good Easter egg with Smarties inside. Let's hope there's no blue ones. We know what they do.
Okay, all right, so I've actually got a very special box here. My eggs. I brought my Easter eggs with me to show you all this morning because I think we've just heard the reading, we've seen a poem read to us, and we've been reminded of the Easter story. So, I need some children to come and help us, just to help us understand what we've just seen. And we're going to do it with my special eggs. All right, so you're going to come and help us see what's in my eggs. All right, so who's going to come up and help? I need some children. Come on, any of you can come up. Come on up, because we've got six, and we can have a look together, can't we? Don't worry about it. I can pick that up. There we go. All right, so we've got the Easter story to be reminded of through my special eggs. Yeah, you do. Okay, so let's have a look. Now, here, first of all, we're going to take it in turns, all right? We need to look for egg one. Look at the picture. What colour is egg one? It's the blue one, all right? So that's made it easier for you. So who's going to choose? Hang on, let's have a look. I'm going to go to the smallest.
You want to pick the blue one?
Yes, you
pick
the blue one. Let's have a look. Show it to me. Yeah, that's it. Let's have a look inside. All right, so let's have a look. Let's put that there for now. We're just going to have a look because we're reminding ourselves of the Easter story. So let's have a look. Come forward so you can see what's in the egg. You've picked the blue one, so let's have a look in here. Do you want to open it? Open it for me. Let's see what's in there. Let's have a look. Open it. Oh, what's in there? Bread and a grain. Bread. And a grape. So what do you think this is about from the Easter story?
So the bread is Jesus' body.
Yeah, so the bread is Jesus' body, and the grape, what do you think the grape's for?
It's his blood.
And when did we remember that in our Easter story? Can you remember in the Easter week? Adults will remember. Yeah? The Last Supper. So on Maundy Thursday, when Jesus met with his friends, they went up to a room and Jesus had that last meal with his friends and he said, "This is the way that I want you to remember me. This is how I love you. This is how I want you to remember my love." All right, so that's egg one. Let's have a look at egg two. And there we go, we've got a reading there that the adults can have a quick look at that reminds them of that story. So egg two, what colour's egg two? Egg two's green. Egg two's green. Do you want to open this one? We're going to the smallest again. Number two, that one. The middle one, isn't it? Choose that one. Yeah. And then you get your sister to open it, or you can open it. Let's see what's in this one.
What's in egg two? Ooh, careful. Let's have a look. What is it? What is it? Well, in the egg, everybody, is this tiny little, it's come unravelled, but it was a crown of thorns. And it's very, very sharp, prickly thorns. They've done very well. So what's the thorns about? It's about the...
It's for the crown.
And
when did the...
Yeah.
So the guards made fun of Jesus and they forced this crown of thorns. You're the king of the Jews. Wear this crown. Wear this purple robe. And they forced it on his head. That was horrible, wasn't it? So well done, you're remembering what that... And there again, the soldiers twisted the crown of thorns from John 19, verse 2. Let's have a look for another yellow egg, shall we? It's a yellow egg. Whose turn is this one? You're doing very well already. You're doing superstar. You're very clever. All right, but I'm going to go to another small person here. Yellow egg. This one. The other one. Well done. Well done. Open that one up for me. What's in there? What is it? Shall we have a look? What's in the yellow egg? It's a cross. Now what?
Jesus died on the cross.
Jesus died on the cross. But what did he have to do with the cross before he even got onto the cross. He had to carry the cross. The poor man, didn't he? He had such a difficult time. It's okay, it's really okay. He's going to be ordained, so it's fine. we're training him up. It's all good. But the cross, Jesus had to carry, didn't he? The cross through the streets. Yeah, the crown of thorns thrust on his head, the purple robe, and they ridiculed him as he went through the streets. And those of you who are going to Jerusalem, you will walk that same road. You will walk the same road where Jesus carried the cross. And then, of course, we know that he went up on the cross, didn't he? What a cruel, horrible way to die. But that shows just how much he loves us. Next one, another yellow one. You have done very well. You deserve one. There we go. All right. Let's see. What's in this one? What is it? It's a sponge, he says. It's a sponge. What's the sponge all about? Let's see if someone else knows, because you're doing very well with your ordination training. Let's see if we've got any other potential clergymen or clergywomen here. So, yes?
Is it supposed to be...
No, not the tomb rock. No, no. Dylan. No, it's not the body of Jesus. What is it? No, it's not. It's neither of those. So in the Easter story, Jesus is up on the cross. And again, the soldiers were being really cruel to Jesus, weren't they? They dipped this sponge into vinegar and put it on a stick. And they forced it into his mouth. That's horrible, isn't it? Oh, really horrible. Again, just something that the soldiers were doing. Immediately one of them ran and got a sponge and filled it with wine vinegar and put it on a staff and offered it to Jesus to drink. I'm not sure that's the nicest drink. What do you like to drink? Squash? Lemon juice. Lemon juice? Lemon squash. Yeah, me too. Me too. So the sponge, was horrible, wasn't it? Again, so we've got a few more. We've got a couple more in here. Dylan, you do really well. Go for the green one. See what's in there. So we're doing really well. What's in there? Ah, it's a stone, a big rock, a big stone. So tell me, hang on. Let's come this way. This is supposed to be the rock. So Jesus died, didn't he? Jesus died on the cross. And the stone, he was put in a tomb, a borrowed tomb, and the stone was rolled across the hole, wasn't it? And sealed. And soldiers were put in front of the tomb and protected. No one could get in the tomb. No one, could they? It was protected by Roman centurions. So there we are. The Easter story is coming to an end. What's the last one going to be? I wonder. Rory. Have a look in there for me.
Nothing?
It's empty?
Yeah.
An empty egg. Did you get what was coming? Did you? You said it as well. There we are. So an egg. The purple egg is the tomb. And the purple egg is empty. Even though the stone was sealed, rolled across the tomb with the soldiers in front, still on Easter morning, the tomb was empty. Jesus
rose up.
You got it, preacher man. You're good. Well done. All right, children, you can go see yourself now. Give a round of applause. We're going to think a bit about that together now as adults. He is not here. He has risen. Just as he said, come and see the place where he lay, the greatest miracle that ever happened. That's why we're here this morning. We're celebrating the greatest miracle that ever happened. So, I want to ask you a question and I want to tell you a few stories. Have you ever prayed for a miracle? Now, this is Tanzania. In 2014, I had the opportunity to go to Tanzania. And in Tanzania, the roads that we were going to, Iamasa, which is a village right up in the mountains, high altitude, and the roads were treacherous. And as we drove on these roads, we forever passed these kind of vehicles hanging over the cliff. They were abandoned. Don't worry, they weren't full of people. They were abandoned, but they were pretty hairy. And we were driving around, and we, at that point on our journey, were praying for a miracle. But that's not the miracle that happened. The miracle happened at the end of our time in Tanzania. We had the opportunity for a day safari. And our lovely leader who was working over there, a friend of mine called Andrew, who's a missionary out there, he's not now, he works in Reading, but a missionary out in Tanzania, he had the coach keys. There were a good number of us, there were 13 of us. So he had the coach keys, but we went off traveling on this safari in a safari jeep. And just after we'd been charged by an elephant, which was pretty hairy, let me tell you, he then declares, "I've lost the keys." The elephant wasn't too far back. And he's saying, "He's lost the keys." So we had to pray, "Lord, please help us. Provide us where these keys are. Tell us where these keys are." And he said, "Stop!" And the driver of the jeep stopped, and he looked back, and he could see a glint in the silver of the key, and the sun shining, and they were literally only about 50 yards back. And we just said, "Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord." It would have been a nightmare if we'd lost those keys, the only keys for the coach for our trip. Another little story I want to tell you about, the 1970s. We're going back a little bit. In the 1970, I was born, and then we went out to Africa. We went out to Africa, and my parents were missionaries. My dad was a missionary in Ethiopia. And in Ethiopia, he was proclaiming the gospel. And he was standing up for injustice. And he spoke out against injustice. And the leaders and the government didn't like what he did. So the government put him in a light aircraft and they flew him out to the desert and left him to die. They left him to die. And he should have died. But he got down on his knees and he prayed for a miracle. He prayed, "Lord, if you want me to continue doing this gospel ministry, what you've called me here to do, then please, Lord, save me." And just after he prayed, an Arab turned up on the desert, test driving his brand new Ford Capri, and said to my father, "What are you doing out here in the desert?" And he said, "Well, you know, praying." And he said, "Come on, get in. I'll take you home." And my father said, "Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord." And we know, don't we, of many miracles that we read about Jesus. There's just a few examples of some stories, but we know of many miracles. Jesus calmed the seas. He turned water into wine. He fed 5,000 people. He healed blind Bartimaeus. He made the sick well again. And he raised Lazarus from the dead. Many miracles where we could read and say for ourselves, "Jesus, thank you. Amazing. Praise the Lord." But Jesus' greatest miracle was that he rose from the grave. We're here to celebrate the fact that Jesus rose from the grave early on that Easter morning. He is risen. He is alive. Jesus is resurrected from the dead. The most amazing moment in history that simply changes our everything. For us, it changes our everything, that will change our lives forever. And on this day, as followers of Jesus, we can say, "Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord." So on this Easter Sunday, what's the best way? What's the best way that we can thank and praise him? I want us to go away from here with a bit of a challenge. I want us to think about how can we acknowledge what Jesus has done over the Easter period How can we acknowledge how amazing this miracle is that he's risen from the dead? And in our own lives, how can we best thank and praise him? Well, if we look in our story on Easter morning, Peter, John, and Mary were wonderfully used. The first witnesses of the resurrection were wonderfully used. And they were resurrection people. So that's what I want us to think about for the last few minutes, really, is for us to think about what it means to be resurrection people. To go from here on Easter morning and live out our lives as resurrection people. God used Mary, Peter, and John as witnesses. And God wants to use us too. God wants to use us too as resurrection people so that we will go from here and witness for him. That's what God wants more than anything else for us on this Easter morning. But we need to remember this. It's the very same power that raised Jesus from the dead, that made the corpse sit up, that revitalized dead cells and restored breath to empty lungs. It's that very same power that is in us. And we need to believe in that power. God wants us to be his witnesses as resurrection people. And we need to know that power, understand that power, and live in that power. Trust in that power. The power of the Holy Spirit. It's the same resurrection power that is given to all of us when we ask Christ to be our Savior. So live in that power, know that power, and live out of that power. So as his disciples, as Christians, we need to realize our part in God's bigger story, in being resurrection people, and we need to pray. And we need to pray for miracles. Why do we need to pray for miracles? We need to pray for miracles because our world is crying. Our world is crying. God is crying because his world is crying. We look around at our world, we hear the news, we know that the world is a sad place. And God didn't want it to be that way. That's not the way God had created it to be. So we need to pray for a miracle so that world, his world, is reconciled back to him. That's why we need to be witnesses for him, so that we can tell people of God's love and bring them back to the place where they should be, in a relationship with him. So let's pray that the story of God's reconciliation will continue in us, through us, as his witnesses, in his power, in this crying, sad world. When we put our trust in him as resurrection people, our lives will be transformed. Our values, our perception, how we see others will be transformed. We will see things differently because we will begin to see things with God's eyes. And as we do that, we will naturally live out our lives as resurrection people, in his power, and naturally witness in our relationships, in our everyday, whatever it is we're doing, we will naturally live out that wonderful story of God's love. The world, God's people, we need to see with his eyes. So he longs. He longs for us to pray. He longs for us to pray for that miracle to happen. And he longs for us to get involved. God longs for the world and his people to be restored and reconciled back to him. So that's why we celebrate Easter. That's why we celebrate Easter. Jesus went through that suffering that we talked about with the children, that amazing love that was shown for each one of us. He went through that suffering so that he could then rise again and give us the opportunity to have new life with him. We understand that new life. We want the whole world to understand that new life too and be reconciled back to him through the cross. It's a powerful story. It's a powerful story deliberately so that we would understand that miracles do happen. And we need to pray for a miracle. Philippians 3 verse 10 writes this. We're going to, in a minute, watch some music. And then on your chairs, you would have seen that there's a card. There's an opportunity. This text is on the card and the prayer we're going to say after the music together. If you'd like to say the prayer, you can together. But we've got an opportunity here on Easter morning to say to God, God, I mean business. I want to be involved. I want to be a resurrection Christian. I want to live for you. So, Philippians 3, Paul writes, I want to know Christ. Yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participation in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death. Well, resurrection people, that's what you are. Let's understand and know that power for ourselves. And then we're going to say the prayer and then we're going to our service. But let's listen to some music together. Here it comes.
His son, they called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He bled and died to buy my pardon, an empty grave is there to prove that my Savior lives, because he lives, I can face to tomorrow, because he lives, all fear is gone, because I know, oh, he holds the future. And life is worth the living just because he lives. How sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy he gives.
But greater still, the calm assurance this child can face uncertain days, because he fight no war with pain. And then as day
to say this prayer. It might be for the first time for some of you. It might be a prayer of recommitment for others. But we're not going to say it out loud. We're going to say it quietly in our own hearts. And the card is for you to put your name in the text of Philippians 3 and to keep as a reminder of your commitment because he lives. So let's just be quiet for a moment. And I'm going to say this prayer. Say it quietly in your own hearts as I say it. Risen Lord Jesus, I come to you as Saviour, asking you to forgive me for all the wrong things I have thought, said, and done in my life. I choose to turn away from everything that I know is wrong. Thank you that you offer me the gift of new life. I want to receive the gift again. So on this Easter morning, I commit myself to witness to you again. Help me to know the power of your resurrection and to believe. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.